This lecture video deals with one type of chemical reaction that we call a precipitation reaction. In this lesson, you will learn how to predict the active species of a precipitation reaction and how to describe these types of reactions by converting between a molecular equation, a complete ionic equation, and a net ionic equation. Before watching this video, you may want to refresh yourself on the concepts that you learned in the videos titled Aqueous Solutions and Predicting the Solubility of Ionic Compounds, which you'll find in our module on solutions. When two or more ionic compounds are dissolved together, they can recombine to form products. So as you'll recall from those previous lessons, when we have an ionic compound dissolved in water, it forms what we call an aqueous solution. This means that the cation and anion completely separate in space and become surrounded each by water molecules. Therefore, if we have more than one ionic compound in an aqueous solution combined together, each of the ions from each of the compounds is freely floating as a distinct particle from its original solid compound. That means that the cations and anions are no longer associated with the compound that they originated from, but can recombine to form new products. A precipitation reaction occurs when these possible new products result in a compound that is no longer soluble in water. Here's an example looking at what happens if we take an aqueous solution of sodium carbonate and combine it with an aqueous solution of magnesium sulfate. From looking at the molecular formula, or rather the formula unit of these ionic salts, we can see that sodium carbonate is formed by two sodium ions and one carbonate ion. So that means when aqueous, we have two Na plus, so two sodium ions, and one CO32 minus, carbonate ion. Now that each of these ions is free floating, they can happen to come upon each other and bam, react. So looking at the possibilities, if sodium originally was with carbonate and magnesium was originally with sulfate, and those were both aqueous, meaning soluble in water, we can ask the question of what would happen if sodium combines with sulfate or magnesium combines with carbonate. It turns out that sodium and sulfate together would also make an aqueous solution. However, magnesium and carbonate together form a solid. This is because the interaction between a magnesium cation and the carbonate anion is stronger than the interaction between each of these ions and water. While the lesson on predicting ion solubility is very good at getting at an understanding of why some ionic compounds are soluble in water and why others are not, it is a little tedious to have to go through Coulomb's law each time we want to predict whether we're going to get an insoluble product. To simplify that question, you will be using a solubility table. The way we look at these tables is they are separated into four distinct parts. On the left, we are looking at the ions that are typically soluble on the top or insoluble on the bottom. And then on the right, we have the exceptions to each rule. What this table is saying is that these small 1+ cations, like ammonium, lithium, sodium, potassium, rubidium, and cesium, are always going to form a soluble ionic salt with no exceptions. On the other hand, these halogens, chlorine, bromine, and iodine, they tend to form soluble compounds, and when combined with most cations, will not form a solid precipitate. However, there are exceptions. So if any of these halogen ions combines with either silver, mercury 2, 2 plus, or lead 2, it will form an insoluble product. So that is an exception to the general idea that chloride, bromide, and iodide are typically soluble. Looking at the lower half of the table, this shows us that a lot of these 2 minus ions, like carbonate, chromate, phosphate, and sulfide, tend to form insoluble compounds, meaning if they combine with most cations, we will get a solid precipitate. The exception being the group 1 cations and ammonium. So basically, the exception being if it combines with ammonium, lithium, sodium, potassium, rubidium, and cesium. Because as we already saw in the top of the table, those cations are always forming soluble ionic salts. Similarly, hydroxide tends to form insoluble precipitates, but it will be soluble if it's combined with one of these always soluble cations, or an additional exception being barium 2+. In addition to solid precipitates, there are other types of products that can come from one of these types of reactions. So again, the simplest way of describing these reactions is as precipitates. So this is when we create a solid by combining 2 aqueous ions. And a good example is lead iodide. If we can combine a soluble iodide solution, for instance, potassium iodide, with a soluble lead solution, let's say lead nitrate, once a lead ion has an opportunity to bang into a iodide ion, they will form lead iodide, which is this yellow-colored solid shown on the right. The second type of product is a gas. So when we say that a product is formed, that means a new molecule has been created that can no longer form ions in solution. So once a solid is formed, it's no longer in solution. If a gas forms, that gas will leave the solution in the form of bubbles. And so it will no longer be in the water anymore, so it is lost. It has become a product. So if a gas is the result of the reaction, then that also counts as a precipitation reaction, even though we are precipitating up and that we are bubbling out of the tube. So a good example of when we have a gas as a product is when we're looking at reactions with carbonates and bicarbonates. Here we see that if we combine an acid, so something that releases H+ ions, combines with carbonate, that produces 2 products, one being carbon dioxide gas, and also liquid water molecules. And I'll talk about that in the next bit of this slide. So the third type of product that can form when we recombine ionic species in solutions are weak acids and bases, or we can call these weak electrolytes. Another example would be pure water. When a hydrogen ion combines with an oxide anion, we're forming a covalent compound, H2O. So that is no longer in solution with water. It is a water molecule. Similarly, if we combine an acid with a salt with an acetate anion, it will produce acetic acid. Acetic acid is a weak electrolyte in that when we dissolve acetic acid into water, only some of the molecules will separate out into the ions you see on the left of the arrow, while some of the ions will remain as a molecular species. We still write AQ because this molecular species is still in solution with water. It is not a gas, it is not a solid, it is a molecule within water. Let's look at how we would write out equations to describe these types of reactions. The goal is to simplify a molecular equation to get down to the species that directly create the product. And this is called a net ionic equation. Here's an example of a reaction between sodium carbonate and magnesium sulfate, forming sodium sulfate and magnesium carbonate, the same example that we saw in the slides before. This first line is the equation as you would expect to see it in your balanced chemical equation segment. And we can see all of the formula units, and we can see that the ions are, or that all of the elements and atoms are balanced on the left and the right of the reaction arrow. It's also very important that we're now paying particular attention to the states of these types of matter. So you see in subscripts, aqueous for the soluble salts, and S indicating the solid precipitate. The total ionic equation shows a clear picture of all of the species as they exist within the solution. Now, it is best if we indicate aqueous next to each of these ions. In this slide, I'm being a little bit lazy just because I wanted to make it fit all in one line. But you should note that, as in the previous example, we do need to write aqueous next to each of the soluble ions. I have here indicated that the product still exists as a formula unit. Notice that the solid is not broken down into its component ions. That's because it isn't in an ionic state once the solid forms. It is in that tube as a solid. The only other species in the sample would be sulfate ions and sodium ions, and of course water. In order to find the net ionic equation, we look for species that appear on both the left and the right-hand side of the arrow, indicating that they are not participating or changing in the course of the reaction. So first we see that sodium exists on both sides of the arrow, then we see sulfate on both sides of the arrow, and we can cancel those out. This leaves us with the net ionic equation. So here I am simply copying down all of the species that I have not canceled out from the total ionic equation. If we did our good job balancing in the previous steps, we should have a balanced net ionic equation. And here I can see one carbonate with a 2- charge combining with one magnesium with a 2+ charge forms magnesium carbonate solid, the net result of having done the reaction. So to sum up, a precipitation reaction can be identified by following these 5 steps and simplifying down to a net ionic equation. In the first step, we look at what the two reactants are and separate them out into their component cations and anions. Now, to predict whether any product is going to form, we're going to swap the partners. So if cation A started out with anion B, we'll see what would occur if we had a reaction between cation A and anion D, and similarly, what would happen if we combined C with B. We check these combinations using our solubility table to see if any of these new ionic compounds are likely to be insoluble and therefore create a product. We would then write out a balanced total ionic equation, cancel out any spectator ions, and that leaves us with the net ionic equation. I recommend you get lots of practice writing out these equations, and you'll get that from your mastering chemistry homework, and also if you're participating in Chem 1A lab in the next week. Thanks for watching. I'll see you again next time.